subscribe to our channel for latest video series on GATE, UGC, NET and more. Also press the bell icon so that you never miss an update on any latest video. For more information, you can visit our website or call on the numbers below. So we're defining the unilateral Laplace transform of a signal xt as integration from 0 to infinity xt e to the power minus st dt. See, if you just look at the limits carefully, lower limit of integration is choose to be 0 minus rather than 0 plus or 0 to permit xt to include delta t. Okay, you know that delta t occurs at t is equal to 0. If I take the limits as 0 plus or 0, then I'm not going to include delta t or its derivative. Okay, so we note immediately that the integration from 0 minus to 0 plus is going to be 0 except when there is an impulse function or its derivative at the origin. Right, so we since xt is a right-handed signal, we considering that this xt is a right-handed signal, causal signal, then ROC of this x1 sx, this is actually xi or x1, whatever you say, this just denotes that this is a unilateral Laplace transform. So this is always going to be real part of is greater than some sigma max, right? That is right half in the s plane. That is why we generally do not define ROC in unilateral transforms. Okay, now if you just look at properties of this unilateral transform, see, most of the properties are going to be the same as bilateral transform only. Okay, this is just useful for calculating the response of a causal system to a causal input. Okay, so basic properties of a unilateral transform that are useful in this application are time differentiation and time integration property. Okay, and which are different from the bilateral transform. Fine, so we're going to look at them only. Other properties are almost the same. So first property that we're seeing is differentiation in time domain. Right? So what do we say? Differentiation in time domain is multiplication in S domain along with initial value. Okay, along with initial value of the signal in time domain. And there's one limitation for this, provided that limit t tends to infinity xt e to the power minus st is equal to 0. That is, this Laplace transform should converge. Okay, if you just repeatedly apply this property, you're going to get d2xt by d2 square is going to be s square xis minus sx0 minus x dash 0 minus. Okay, if you just try to generalize this, then for nth differentiation of the function, going to have okay, where this is defined as, this is actually the differentiation in time domain of the signal, okay, at t is equal to 0 minus, that is initial value of the signal. Okay, we're going to look at few examples of this to apply this property. First we're going to look at the second property, which is integration in time domain. Integration in time domain. Okay, this property is different from bilateral transform in the terms that we are including the initial value of the signal also here. Okay, in bilateral transform we just multiplying the with s in the s domain, right? In unilateral transform you have to include the initial value of the signal as well. Similarly for integration, so integration in time domain is going to be multiplication with 1 by s in the s domain, right? And if you are performing complete integration of the signal, it's going to be okay, this side is going to come here. Okay, so these are the two properties that are different from bilateral transforms. Right, so now we're going to look at two more theorems.
So now we're just going to verify the two properties that we saw for unilateral Laplace transform right now. That is, we're going to verify this equation differentiation in time domain. It's going to be multiplication with S along with the initial value of the system, right? So for just verifying this equation, what am I doing is, I'm taking the unilateral Laplace transform of dxt by dt, which is going to be equal to integration from 0 minus till infinity of dxt by dt e to the power minus st dt. Now I'm performing this integration using parts. Okay, you might have studied integration by parts in intermediate. So what do we do is, we integrate the first function, leave the second, then we just the subtraction. See, this is how you this is u and v. If u, v both are some functions in, let's say, some variable t, then in integration by parts, what you are doing is, we're leaving v and integrating u, subtract, differentiating v and integrating u. Okay, so this is how we're integrating by parts. Okay, so I'm just using this property of integration by parts here. So what do? I leave this e to the power minus st and integrate this function, on which I'm going to obtain xt e to the power minus st, put the limits as 0 to infinity. Okay, then minus, if you integrate this function, okay, see, we're integrating this function, okay, again. Sorry, differentiating. We're differentiating this function. If you differentiate this function, you're going to obtain minus s. Inside integration, you're going to have e to the power minus st. And upon integration of this function, you're going to get xt dt. Limits are going to be the same, right? If you just put the limits here, what are you going to get? This is going to be minus c. E to the power minus infinity is going to be 0. So, we're neglecting this term, subtraction. Lower limit, e to the power 0 is going to 1, so you're going to get minus x0 minus, this is going to become plus s, and this is actually the unilateral transform of xt, right? So this is what our property was, right? We had to verify this property only. That is, differentiation in time is going to have these effects in the S domain. Okay. Now, if you just try to verify the general property also, that is for double differentiation, let's say, we can just verify this also. This is going to be S square xis minus x into 0 minus minus x dash 0 minus. Okay, so what we are saying is that just this property that we have proved right now, okay, this one, we're using this in this equation. Okay, I'm just applying the above property to this equation. Then what are you going to obtain? D2xt by d2 square is d by dt of dxt by dt, right? Double differentiation can be written like this. So if you just take Laplace, what is going to happen? This is going to be s into xi of s minus x of 0 minus minus x dash 0 minus, right? This is what is going to happen just using the above property. Okay, so this is going to be x square xi s minus x 0 dash minus x dash 0 minus. Right, so on continued application of this property only, you can obtain this equation for a general nth differentiation also. Right, now we verify the integration property, that is, integration from 0 minus to t of x tau d tau is going to have Laplace as 1 by s xi of s. Okay, so for that, what am I saying is, I'm considering this function as some other function gt. Let this function be gt, right? So what do I say? Dgt by dt, if I just differentiate it, what am I going to get? I'm going to get xt, and also g at 0 minus is going to be 0. Okay, if you just put t is equal to 0 minus here, that is, integration at a single point is going to be 0, right? Now what do I say? If gt is having unilateral Laplace transform as gi of s, then what is xi of s going to be? Okay, just look from here. Difference. This is differentiation in time property, right? So it's going to be s gi s minus g of 0 minus, already we know this has value 0, which means that gi of s is actually equal to 1 by s xi of s. Or what was gi of s actually? Integration in time domain is going to have the Laplace as 1 by s xi of s. Okay, and for the second property that we saw, that is, if we are taking integration from minus infinity to t of x tau d tau, then this should also be equal to 1 by s xi of s plus 1 by s minus infinity to 0 plus x tau d tau. Now see, what am I doing is I'm just breaking the limits, okay, it's splitting the limits here. Then what can I write this integration as? This can be written as minus infinity to 0 minus x tau d tau plus 0 minus 2t x tau d tau. Right? Now if you look at the first term on the right hand side, this term is going to be a constant, okay? Since it does not have any time limit, okay? Any limit in any variable, it has constant limit. So this term is going to be constant. So if you just take unilateral transform of the above equation, what are you going to get? X tau d tau is going to have Laplace as 1 by s xi of s, which is Laplace of this term, plus 1 by s. This term is going to remain as it is, right? This is a constant term. That is why you cannot take Laplace of this. This term is going to remain as it is. Fine. So this is how you can just prove these two properties. Now we're going to look at two more theorems, which are initial value theorem and final value theorem. Okay, they are applicable for unilateral Laplace transform. So firstly, we're going to look at their statements. Then we'll see at their proofs. Okay, so we look at initial value theorem first. See, there are some limitations on applying initial value theorems and final value theorems. Going to look at those limitations, examples, everything, right? So what does initial value theorem say? Value of a function in time domain, initial value of a function in time domain, that is value of the function at t is equal to 0, can be given by limit s tends to infinity x xs. Okay, initial value of a function in time domain can be given by this limit s tends to infinity x into x of s. Okay, how do we prove this now? So already you know, okay, this is the proof for initial value theorem. So already we know that xi of s minus x of 0 minus, this is actually the Laplace of differentiation of the function dx t by dt e power minus st dt. We just saw this a few minutes back. So what can you write this as? You can write this as just splitting the limits. So this can be written as, right? I've just split the limits. So integration, see, 0 minus to 0 plus, this function e to the power minus st is going to have value 1 only, okay? This is a continuous function at 0. So this is going to have value 1. Integration for this function is going to be x of t with limit 0 minus to 0 plus 0 plus to infinity, right? Now, what can you say? If you just put the limits in, this is going to be x of 0 plus minus x of 0 minus plus 0 plus to infinity integration dx t by dt e to the power minus st dt, right? So what can I say? I can say, see, this LHS we had xis minus x of 0 minus. So these two terms can cancel out. So what can I say? I can say that x into xi of s is equal to x of 0 plus integration from 0 plus to infinity of dx t by dt into e power minus st dt, right? And if you just try to evaluate this limit, okay, I'm just putting limit s tends to infinity on LHS, then what happens to RHS? X of 0 plus is going to remain same because it has no term of s. Limit s tends to infinity is going to apply to this side. Right? Now you can just check, if you just put s is equal to infinity in this equation, what is going to happen? what are you going to obtain? Okay, if you just put s is equal to infinity x, this is going to become e to the power minus infinity, which is 0. So this term is going to vanish. And what are you going to obtain? Okay, I'm going to write one more step for more clarity. See, I can just apply this limit to this e to the power st, right? Because only this term has s. So if you just apply this limit, this term is going to become 0. 0 multiplied with anything is going to become 0. So what do I get? I get limit s tends to infinity x xis is going to give me x of 0 plus, which is initial value of the function in time domain. Okay, so this theorem is known as initial value theorem. That is, you can calculate the initial value of a signal in time domain, that is the value of the signal at t is equal to 0, by calculating this limit. Okay, then we are having one more theorem like this, which is final value theorem. Final value theorem. Now, what does this theorem say? What is the statement of this theorem? Final value of a signal, that is value of the signal at t is equal to infinity, can be given by limit s tends to 0 x into x of s. Okay, by calculating this limit, you can calculate the final value of the signal in time domain. Right. So again, look at the proof of this theorem also. How are we proving it? So we are applying the limit s tends to infinity to the same equation that we have used in the previous proof. So I am applying limit s tends to infinity to both the sides of the equation that we used previously. Now, if you just apply this limit, what is going to happen? Look at the RHS now, right? Only this term has s, so the limit is going to apply to this only. So this is going to become, see, limit s tends to 0 when you're applying, this term is going to become 1. So you're going to obtain integration from 0 minus 2 infinity dx t by dt into dt, right? Which is actually equal to integration, this integration is going to be equal to x t with limits from 0 minus 2 infinity, right? What can you write this as? This can be written as limit t tends to infinity x t minus x of 0 minus, right? Now we compare this with the LHS. So what did we have in the LHS? We had limit s tends to 0 x of xis minus x of 0 minus. And what do we have on the RHS? We have limit t tends to infinity x t minus x of 0 minus. Now if you just separate these terms, what is this going to become? This is going to become limit s tends to 0 x of xis. Since this term has no terms in s, I can just write it separately, right? Now if you see, we have similar term on both the sides, so we can just cancel it out and we can conclude that limit t tends to infinity x t, that is final value of the signal in time domain, is equal to limit s tends to 0 s into x s. That is final value of a signal in time domain, value of the signal at t tending to infinity is going to be can be calculated by calculating this limit s tends to 0 x of x I s. Now see, one thing that you have to keep in mind, this initial value theorem and final value theorem are not always applicable. Okay, there are some limitations for these theorem to be applicable. Okay, what are these limitations? See, we're going to look at this using some examples. So suppose you have some Laplace transform of this form, s plus 5 upon s square plus 3s plus 2. Okay, of course you can just factorize it and do partial fractions. Suppose you obtain something of the form a upon s plus 1 into b upon s plus 2. These are going to be the two factors. Okay, we are not concerned with the values of a and b right now. Then what is going to be a f of t? It is going to be a e to the power minus e t u t plus b e to the power minus 2 t u t. Like now if you look at the initial value of this system, if you try to find out the value of the signal at t is equal to 0, then it is going to be some finite value. This is going to be finite value. That means f of 0 is going to be defined, right? That means that initial value theorem is applicable in this case. Okay, now consider one more example. Suppose you have f of s as s square plus 2s plus 3 upon s square plus 3s plus 2. Right, now this can be written as 1 plus something, right? 1 plus cs plus d upon s square plus 3s plus 2, something of this form, right? We're not concerned with the partial fraction expansion of this right now. Now what is f of t going to be? F of t is going to be something of the form del of t plus some function. Now if you see f of 0, if you try to find out value of this signal at t is equal to 0, that is not going to be defined. Why? Because this contains an impulse function, which means that initial value theorem is not applicable in this case. Okay, not applicable. If you just find the limit, if you just try to find out this limit, limit s tends to infinity, s of fs, maybe you're going to get some finite answer. Okay, this may exist sometime, but we need to check if firstly that if whether this initial value theorem is actually applicable or not applicable. Okay, we need to check first. So how are we going to check? Okay, how can we check? See, initial value theorem, what is the condition to apply initial value theorem? We're going to see now. For initial value theorem to be applicable to a signal, signal must be a proper rational function. Only when, okay, you can just note this, note. Initial value theorem is applicable only to proper rational functions. Okay, if you are having improper rational function, that is if degree of numerator is more than or equal to the degree of denominator, initial value theorem cannot be applied in that case. Right, now look at some examples for final value theorem. What happens to final value theorem? Okay, when can you apply final value theorem? So obviously if final value is not defined or undeterminable, we are going to say that final value theorem is not applicable. Now how do we judge that? Let us look at some examples now. Suppose you have given f of s as 1 by s. Now you know that inverse Laplace for this is going to be u of t, right? And value of this function at infinity is going to be 1, which is a defined value. That means the final value theorem is applicable to this kind of function. Now suppose you had f of s equal to 1 by s square, for which inverse Laplace is ramp function r of t, and whose final value f of infinity is undefined. Okay, if you just try to calculate limit s tends to 0, s of fs, even then you're not going to get a finite value. Okay, you're going to get infinity only, which means undefined value itself. But in some functions, you're going to get this integral. Okay, you'll be able to calculate this limit, but final value for those functions are not going to be defined. So how do you see? Right, how do you check? So what are we saying is final value theorem is applicable. See, we can judge this using the poles of the system. Okay, how are we seeing this? What we are saying is for final value theorem, if for f into fs, poles lie in the right half of S plane, only then what is going to happen? Ft or f infinity cannot be determined. This is going to be a undefined or indeterminate value. Okay, so if poles of SFS lie in the right half of S plane, we say that final value theorem is not applicable. That is, poles must lie in left half of S plane. Okay, poles must lie in left half of S plane. That is, the system or the signal must be stable for final value theorem to be applicable. Right, so this is the only condition, and for initial value theorem we must have a proper rational function. So these are the two conditions that we have to apply on initial value and final value theorem. right? These are the two conditions that you have to keep in mind when you are applying this initial value and final value theorem. So these are going to be a lot of useful for you when you use them in network theory. Okay,